Hello, thank you very much. We are Horns, and this is we're going to play originals today, and this one is called The Wings from Sligo. We're going to play Raindrops from Stormland now. Thank you. Okay, we're going to finish out now with another original, which we call Scottish Scouts Skating the Sky on Scooters. Thank you. Thank you very much. This is Stefano, and I am Pedro. We are Horns. We're on Facebook. Thank you very much.
Good evening. You are very, very welcome to the third in a series of five climate conversations. My name is Chris Chapman. I've been looking after some of the audience engagement and thinking a bit about where's it all going and not just having great events along the way. And I have a very quick job at the beginning of this evening to do a few thank yous and just to talk a little bit about the continuity, to talk about the last two events that we did and also a little bit about the next two, about where we think we're going. So thank you very much to Horns for playing us in. Stefano and Pedro, excellent stuff. And hopefully if we run reasonably to time, they'll play us out at the end as well. So that's a bit to kind of bookmark the event. So climate conversations, this slide we've got on the graphic here tells us a little bit about what it is. It's six partners coming together, and just the very fact of these partners coming together is really significant. They're not partners who work together in the normal run of things. Six partners coming together around climate in iconic venues. So we were in Liberty Hall the first night, Trinity the second night, Guinness Storehouse tonight, next time Christchurch, finally the Abbey Theatre. So yeah, really significant venues that we're working with. Just want to say the thank yous to the people involved in the partners. So we've got Liam Burney and David Joyce from ICTU, Neil Walker from Ibec, Teresa Carter at the back there from the Environmental Pillar. Was that a cheer? That's great. Sawley McCaughey from Christian Aid, Lorna Gold from Trócaire. And then we also have this climate gathering piece in the middle. There's a bit of support from people from FASTA, which is a sustainability and economics think tank, Willie Kiefel, particularly, Paddy Kirby, Paul Harris from Bank of Ireland's been around in the background. Loads of people have been working together to make this happen, which is just great. We're at the third event, so we're at the purple dot in our journey of coming together here. We described this as a discovery phase, so it might seem a bit all over the place, but we're hunting around, trying to work out how to deal with these things. How can we find the way to work together? The fourth event we're going to move on to in a couple of weeks' time is a more reflective, maybe slightly deeper process, where we're really going to go for so what? Go down a level, listen to some prophetic voices. And then the fifth event in the Abbey Theatre is the call to action. So I can just move to the next slide. It's Anna on slides who's been doing all the admin. She should get a thanks as well. And Owen on multimedia. Owen, who thought he was just coming to do the camera work and ends up having to do the sound and the slides and everything else as well. So we're particularly grateful for that. At the first event then, one of the things we did, we asked people, how many of you were at the first event? Liberty Hall, hands up. Cool. Great that you came back. So at the first event, you will remember, the others will not know. One of the things we did very quickly was we said to people, when climate change comes up in the media, when it comes up in discussion, what feelings does it prompt? How do you feel? And these were some of the key words that came up. I think the most important message, we looked at about 180 people made responses to that question. And the most important message was, there are loads of feelings and they're all over the place. Yeah? So if you're working with a big bunch of people around climate change, all of this stuff comes up. It's all in the room. The biggest one was frustration, but there's also anger, despair, anxiety, feelings about the children, some positive ones around hope, but a real mixture, a really, really mixed up bunch of feelings. If we can move to the second slide or the next slide. The second thing that we said to people then was, Okay, these partners have come together to work around climate change. What would you like them to focus on? What were the questions you'd like them to really get into and answer? And again, we had loads and loads and loads of stuff, and we will share this in a fuller version probably in the last event, but just for now, just to give some highlights. One of the things that came across really strongly was this sense of, well, what, you know, coming out of the frustration, what can an ordinary person do? What can I do? There's this big issue about the entire world and the path of human civilization. What can I do? Is a pretty good question. There were some excellent versions of, actually, do you know what? Ireland can play a really positive role. Ireland has the potential to be something special and significant in the world that no other country can be. And let's just put our finger on exactly what that is. Some big, difficult questions about some people saying we need to change the entire economic system, and other people saying, whoa, too much. But there's things to deal with there, you know, is, you know, to grasp with. Which bits of this are built into the economic system we have? Can we mainstream these conversations? So we're really aware that, you know, 200 or 300 people in a room are 200 or 300 people who are into it. And there's obviously a few million people who aren't. So, you know, there's work to do. And coming up with a positive vision, so not just gloom and doom and despair, but can we come up with a positive vision to inspire and motivate? And then we came back to that at the second event. So if we move on to the last slide, you'll be grateful there aren't loads of slides. At the second event then, the focus was in Trinity was on a new economy. How many people were there? Cool, great. Thank you very much, good to see you. So at the end of the second event, it was loads of speakers, really good, loads of really, really good inputs. We asked very quickly this question that's at the top there. What needs to be central in a vision for a new economy for it to be really motivational? So there was a lot of talk about new economy, different economy, Green New Deal, whatever language you want to put on it. What needs to be central for a vision for it to be really motivational? And again, we'll just pick up on a few of the bits. But again, we had this role of Ireland as innovator inspiring. So if Ireland could actually say, do you know what, we can do something really special, that could be something very significant people can gather around. People talking about the role of education, so maybe that there's something the partners could do to work together in schools. People talking about what they'd like from government, the kind of leadership they'd like. Self-sufficiency in energy and sustainable agriculture, and obviously that's a lot of the focus this evening in that direction. Happiness, justice, equity, just transition. It's not actually up there, but this phrase, the just transition, seems to have stuck for quite a lot of people. Community, triple bottom line. So we're exploring a territory. It's not coherent. We're going through this loop. We're only kind of halfway through the loop that we're going through. We're not expecting to have all the answers yet. So this evening, we're going to get into sustainable land use with a particular focus on food. I'm going to hand over to Catherine Cleary from the Irish Times, who's going to curate, I believe the word is, for that for this evening. Thank you very much, Catherine.
Thanks, Chris. Great to hear you. Can everybody hear me? I hear me down the back, good stuff. I kind of need the last slide with all those terrible emotions because that's what I'm feeling churning in my stomach today. I am way out of my comfort zone doing this. My job is to just try and sit down every week and figure out how to tell you in an interesting and entertaining way about my dinner. So I'm also aware that I've pushed other people out of their comfort zones to come and talk to you tonight. But I think what we're going to have is a really interesting, I'm really interested to hear what the people who are have all agreed. And the amazing thing about organizing this is when I asked people, nobody said no, everybody said yes. There's a huge appetite for what we're going to talk about here tonight. And I'm delighted to see so many people here on this beautiful evening that you've sacrificed a rare, beautiful evening in Dublin to come and sit here. And I hope you're going to enjoy the evening. My first job is to introduce David Croft, who's the man who's given us the lend of the room for the night. He's Diageo's sustainability director, and he's going to talk very briefly about how the corporate world might cope with the climate challenge. David.
I'll bob up on here so you can hear me. Good evening, everybody, and on behalf of Diageo, welcome to the Guinness Storehouse. It's a fantastic pleasure for us to host this event tonight. particularly here, the heart of over 250 years of Guinness brewing, and these days very much also a huge part of our future with the new brew house that we opened up across the road just last year. Just a couple of points about that. That particular building and the kit that we put in there means that every pint of Guinness has 10% less CO2 and greenhouse gas in its making. We use 14% less water every time we make a whole brew. And they're the sorts of things that we within Diageo have been thinking about in terms of how we frame our business for the future. You know, and frankly, you know, you don't go and spend the better part of 170 million euros on a new brewing operation without really thinking for the long term. Where we want to be in the future, where our business needs to be to look after the contribution we make to society and the environment that we exist in. We're thinking about the next 5 years because we've set our next targets for 2020. But actually our focus is on 2030 and even as far out as 2050. And I think that's absolutely aligned to the legacy that Arthur Guinness created for us when he signed the incredibly long lease here for this site over 250 years ago. My own journey to get here has come through some fairly wide and diverse companies, actually. I've been with Co-op in the UK, I've been with Cadbury working out of the Coolock plant over here, and I've been with Waitrose, another UK supermarket. But what it's taught me now I'm here at Diageo is that business is taking the question of sustainability increasingly seriously. Part of that is because many leading businesses like Diageo see the need to continue the legacy that people like Arthur Guinness, or in our case Johnny Walker as well, created. But partly it's also because thinking about the long-term future makes for a better business, makes for a more sustainable business. And if we can bring those ideas of sustainability, some of which we'll talk about later tonight, into the core of our business, not fundamentally change direction, but just shift direction through 1 or 2 degrees, then our contribution to the environment and to society at large will grow in the way that Arthur Guinness inspired us to all those years ago. I think also, here in Ireland, there is a huge legacy and a huge future. We are, as we'll talk about later, I think, in terms of the land, one of the biggest customers of Irish agriculture. We use over 300 tons of barley a day in terms of how we manufacture Guinness. If you discount the dairy co-ops, we're the largest single customer for milk in Ireland. And given all of that, it's hugely important for us that the conversations we'll have here become embedded in our core strategy going forward. And that's why we work with people like Glanbia, who you'll hear later, to work closely with those dairy farmers and have long-term relationships and think about how we can work at that level even to think about emissions, whilst we also have to think about the emissions of carbon and the use of water in our factories. One of my own goals, if I think just for a moment beyond the environment, is about how we enable thriving communities for the future. Working together and linking together that social, environment and economic sustainability that will support long-term futures. And at the heart of that are people, because people will help those activities come to pass and will sustain them. And that's the reason why we were pleased to host this event. Thinking about land and agriculture at the heart of our business, but with a group of people who want to contribute their ideas. Collaboration, as we see in this type of event, is going to be hugely important. And I think it will be essential if we're going to bring together diverse groups, diverse opinions, in a way that will create robust and balanced solutions. And on that note, thank you again for joining us. Here's to a great conversation from which all that collaboration will flow for a sustainable future for us all. Thank you.
Thanks very much, David. Next up, we have Dr. Paul Dean, who's from UCC. He's an energy expert, and he's going to give us an energetically short presentation on agriculture emissions, the cars versus cows debate. Here's everything you ever wanted to know about cows and carbon.
Thanks, Catherine. That's a great introduction. Energy expert, I'm not so sure. I think more appropriately, let me just qualify my credentials for tonight. I grew up on a farm in Kerry, a small 40-acre farm just outside Tralee in the 80s, which wasn't really the golden era of Irish agriculture. So I think I've been trampled by cows. I've fallen off silage pits. I pulled myself out of slurry pits. So I think anything I've learned about agriculture has been either through economic hardship or physical hardship. But tonight, let me talk about something a small bit different. I'm going to share with you some of the elements of Irish agriculture. Not the most interesting elements, unfortunately, the elements around emissions and the elements around climate and energy policy. I have 5 minutes. I've got to do this energetically, so I'm not going to get to know you. We're going to jump straight into this. I'm going to hit you with some hard facts, so hang on to your seats. Here we go. Agriculture is vitally important to Ireland, not only culturally, economically, socially, but the economic aspect is enormous, 24 billion into our economy. And we export most of our agricultural produce that we produce here in Ireland, and that's important. In terms of land use, about 80% of the agricultural land is given over to grass and 10% to crops. And another important point to remember is that the dairy that we produce here in Ireland has got one of the lowest carbon footprints in the world. So in terms of the dairy that we produce, Ireland is more or less world class. The beef, a little bit behind that. Interestingly enough, we have the lowest level of organic land in Europe. We're less than 2%. Austria would be the highest at about 17%. And we also have the lowest level of forestry cover in Europe. In terms of demographics, it's certainly a male-dominated sector. 12% of farms are owned by females, and it's certainly an older and maybe a wiser man's game, where the average age of a farmer is in his late 50s, and 30% of farms are owned by people who are over the age of 65. So there's some quick facts on agriculture. But Ireland is actually very unique in terms of its place in Europe and how we think about agriculture and its interactions with energy. You know, when we often think about climate change, we think about, you know, power plants belching CO2 out into the atmosphere. But for Ireland, it's very different. For us, it's the majority of our emissions come from agriculture, primarily from cattle who belch, and then the rest of those emissions come from manure management and fertilizer. So up here, what we see is how we consume energy in Ireland today. And you notice that electricity is 20% of the electricity that we consume, but still it dominates the airwaves in conversations that we have in Ireland around climate change. Agriculture consumes very little energy, but still produces the majority of our emissions, 32%. That's about 18 million tons. Just to break that down for you, that's about 4.5 times what Money Point coal-fired power plant pumps into the atmosphere every year. So it's about 4.5 times Money Point. And just a little factoid, a cow will generally produce the same emissions as an average family car every year. So you can look at your car in that way. And we have a lot of emissions in Ireland. It's not that agriculture is not efficient in Ireland. It is very efficient. It's just that we have lots of cows. We have 6 million cows, 6.3 million or more or less, or cattle to be exact. And it's not easy to reduce emissions in agriculture. The most effective way is to reduce activity in the sector, and that's kind of a cold economic word for saying you get rid of the cows and get rid of some of the farms. So, and emissions are 32% today, about 18 million tons. Projections out to 2030 would show that emissions more or less staying around between 18 and 19 million tons of CO2. So not much movement in those projections as we go out to the future. Part of the work that we do down in UCC, this is a Sankey diagram. This is this very colourful diagram, explains how energy flows into the Irish system, where we get our energy from, the fuel types, and the sectors that we use it in. So again, you can see agriculture in terms of energy is more or less insignificant. The emissions are not shown here, but we saw them on the last slide. And part of the work that we do down in UCC is that we use computer models to understand how this picture of the energy system in Ireland will develop, will evolve as the economy evolves, as prices of fossil fuel evolve, and how our level of ambition for climate change, how that interacts with the energy system as well. Now, we use computer models, and the wonderful thing about computer models is that if you like the story coming from them, you can say it's great, there's science behind it, there's mathematics, this must be true. And the other great thing is that if you don't like the story, you can say it's a computer model and it's rubbish and they're completely wrong. So, but computer models are very useful. We don't make predictions with computer models. If we could predict the future, we would probably end up doing something about it. So what we generally do is that computer models provide insights, they provide scenarios, they provide information of how things may evolve under a certain set of conditions. So the work that we do in this project, and this project is funded by the EPA and SEAI, is that we look how this picture will change out to the year 2050. And when we're looking at the energy system in Ireland, what's very important is to understand, well, what happens to agriculture, the bulk of our emissions. And in that conversation, two narratives really evolve. The first one kind of says, well, we need to acknowledge the low carbon intensity of Irish agriculture. We need to acknowledge the contribution that Irish agriculture makes to global food production. And we need to maybe give some kind of special consideration for emissions coming from agriculture, or some kind of a pass, if you will, when it comes to emissions from agriculture. And the logic for that is really founded in the fact that if we reduce the herds here in Ireland, if we stop producing as much milk, the markets will remain and the production of the produce will move elsewhere. And there's some really good literature out there to show that while we may reduce emissions in Ireland, that will probably lead to a global overall increase in emissions. So that's one argument for saying that, well, you know, we need to consider agriculture and it needs to be looked at differently in consideration of its low carbon contribution. The other argument says, well, you know, well, rubbish that. You know, every sector must do its must pull its weight. If we start making considerations or making dispensations for Irish agriculture, well, then shouldn't coal in Poland get the same treatment? Shouldn't steel in Germany get the same treatment? So they're the kind of two arguments that evolve when we talk about where agriculture goes into the future. And both have merit, and I think both have weaknesses and both have strong points. Let's look at one of our graphs here from the year 2050. So let's jump into the future. And we will be talking a little bit about 2050 later on. This Sankey diagram shows one specific scenario of what the energy system in Ireland, now the energy system is just heat, transport, and electricity. What the energy system would look like if we reduced our emissions by 80%. And we can achieve this at a cost that's more or less comparable to what other EU member states can achieve. You know, so it's technically and economically very plausible and very feasible. If we look at agriculture on this, if you want to achieve an overall economy-wide 80% reduction, and the reason why I'm using 80% is that 80% is the figure that we reckon we need to reduce global greenhouse gas emissions to keep temperatures to a 2-degree increase. So that's where the 80% comes in. If we look at an overall economy reduction of 80%, that means then that agriculture has to significantly reduce its emissions by 80% or greater. And that's very, very challenging. And we're going to hear maybe later on about some of the options for and some of the challenges and maybe some of the opportunities for reducing emissions from agriculture. What our analysis also shows is that, well, what if agriculture cannot significantly reduce its emissions? What happens then? And then the issue is, well, the burden gets flipped back over to the energy system. The energy system will need to do more. Let me throw out two examples. If agriculture can reduce its emissions by half, then the energy system to achieve an 80% reduction will look something like this. The energy system will have to go over and above 80% and reduce emissions by 95%. Technically, it's possible, but it's an energy system which is an awful lot more expensive. If we go beyond that, and just to finish up, what if agriculture cannot reduce its emissions? What if emissions stay in 2050 at 18 million tons, the same they are today? Then, to achieve an emissions reduction of 80%, the energy system must produce negative emissions. And I have no diagram for that because it is impossible. So the take-home message that I would like to add to this conversation is what happens in agriculture in Ireland matters in energy, more so than any other member state. There are trade-offs culturally, environmentally, socially, and economically. We need to be mindful of these trade-offs, but the trade-offs are not just at a local level in terms of communities, they can also be at a global level in terms of overall emissions production from greenhouse gases. So thank you very much for listening.
Thanks, Paul. I think that sums up something that I had a conversation with somebody about this, where the idea that this isn't something that we can corral into a circle and say, this is only going to affect the farmers. This is something that's going to affect everybody. And I think that really highlighted that for everybody very clearly and very brilliantly. Thanks, Paul. Our next speaker is poet and publisher Peter Fallon. At the tender age of 18, he set up the Gallery Press. He moved down to Loch Crewe, just outside Oldcastle in Meath, to become a farmer. He farmed sheep for 15 years, and he published some of the biggest names in Irish writing. And he's gonna do a reading. He's feeling, as I say, very much out of his comfort zone. But I reassure him. I've read his poetry, and it is wonderful. And he's going to do a reading, and he's also going to talk a little bit about a life in writing and a life in farming. So, Peter Fallon, thank you.
Thank you. That did indeed need to be said. When Catherine asked if I would come and speak and read some poems, I did say, "Are you sure about this?" She said she was, and I said, "Don't blame me." When I returned to live permanently in the countryside of North County Meath, a hen's race from my home place, my uncle's farm near Kells, while I was still an undergraduate at Trinity College in this city, I sensed that I wanted to shape a life around the poems I was trying to write, the books of poems and plays by other writers I'd begun to publish under the imprint The Gallery Press, and an active engagement with farming in and around an old house I'd found in Loch Crewe. And for most of the 80s and 90s, I raised sheep and tried to build a flock to my liking. But all the while, I was aware, of course, that I was entering a tradition of 20th century Irish poetry that included writers like Patrick Kavanagh, John Montague, Seamus Heaney, whose work reflected a childhood on farms and in rural communities. But what for them was recollection, I trusted for me would be an ongoing practice and participation and experience. Their subject would be a reimagination of the past. I would attempt to record a present. And attracted as I was to the element that seemed to suit me, I was alert always to the truth of Wordsworth's lines in his poems on Tintern Abbey, his knowing that nature never did betray the heart that loved her. Despite such reassurance, I felt somewhat alone in Ireland in my undertaking and endeavor. In England, Ted Hughes was writing the poems that are called his Moortown Diary, but my true affinities and allegiances were with writers in America, where the thinking, the conversation, the awareness seemed more advanced. And I mean people like Gary Snyder, Donald Hall, and above all, my dear friend and hero, Wendell Berry. I took hope from my correspondence and conversations with them, both in the United States and in Loch Crewe. Despite the assaults on that hope, as I remembered an earlier writer, the Scots-American naturalist, John Muir, who died just 101 years ago and who has become the patron saint of wilderness. What he wrote was once true, I'm sure, though now I have my doubts about it, and that is, earth hath no sorrows that earth cannot heal. Allow me, please, to read two poems from my book, Strong My Love. 2 years ago, I spent a year in residence teaching at Boston College. It was, you'll remember, a punishing winter, and I wrote these lines in some sort of helpful, distant sympathy. A winter wound. Tears in his eyes. From an east wind and ice rain, and surely more sinned against than sinning. He stared as the bullocks turned back to confront a bare stall. Had even the frosts not burned the leaves from the briars? In all the years that he remembers, there was never the like, with its four Novembers and the two or three Januaries, when any weather's switch or swerve bore more adversaries. I've known those nights up at the lambing, snow-blind, when you'd search for what you hoped you wouldn't find. I've seen those gaunt beasts haunt the marts, felt the heart sink of false starts in the low moans of livestock, known the hurt hope of herd and flock, and heard his spirit say, this will not end, not soon or in a time to come, because it happened. And I finish with a poem called Light in the Sorrow Field. And I thank you for the invitation and for your attention. She tilled and toiled in her own sorrow field, and found that grief's a place none knows till it's revealed by entering it. That there'd be joys of night, she stored the gems of waking hours and prayed to see morning's delight. A widow woman, not like the bird in constant fright and flight from hawks by day and owls by failing light. She reckoned earth and knew demise of cowslips between hedgerow and silage strips, a preview of apocalypse. What once were farms, she'd say, are now food factories. Between hay and harvest time, the wheels of years accelerate till winter changes gears and they capitulate. More like the hare, field faring and following its holy orders to lie low, true to form, to be itself within the borders of what's now, that she sees through gap or gate, and though the wind cuts like a knife, tells, go, long-lugged, long-legged one, run for fun, run for your life. Thank you.
Thank you so much, Peter. About 3 or 4 weeks ago now, after I tasted her fantastic food, I asked Chef Katie Sanderson to become a food womble. She's probably too young to get that cultural reference, but I wanted her to gather up the stuff that everyday folk leave behind, the food waste and transform it, as she does with ingredients, into something delicious to eat. The idea grew legs, and we asked another wonderful woman called Isolt Ward to come along, because she set up, she's a social entrepreneur who set up something called the Food Cloud, and I'll get her to tell you about that. And then we got a great man called Jack Roach, who runs a greengrocer's on Mead Street. He'll be handing out cards, I'm sure, before he leaves the room, to get involved. And finally, we have a great lineup from Galway tonight, I realise now. There's quite a Galway contingent. The great chef, Jess Murphy, who, when I told Jack she was a Kiwi, he said he wished he'd brought a Kiwi. I'm sure that's never happened to her before. So Jess has come from Galway with lots of amazing ingredients that she's also foraged. She actually did some skip diving this morning, I think, to find. But don't let that put you off, and you're all going to get to taste it. So I'll invite them all up here to tell me about what they've been doing. Katie, Jess, Isolt, and Jack. Thanks. Welcome, everybody. I'll pass around the mic, but I'm gonna talk to Isolt first. Do you want to sit down, or will we stand? We'll stand. Let's sit down. Okay, let's sit down. Katie needs to sit down. She's been slaving. Brilliant. Thanks, Chris. Now, and I'm going to talk to Isolt first. So is saying the food cloud like saying the Twitter? It's actually food cloud, isn't it? It's one of those new digital things that you don't call the food cloud. It's food cloud. But sorry, that's a joke that fell very flat. What? Tell me what. Explain what it is, how you set it up, and what does it do?
So I suppose I'll start with how we set it up. It was over 2 years ago, and I was studying in university, and I met Evan O'Brien, who's the other co-founder of Food Cloud. And it was really the realization that within communities, there were businesses that were throwing out surplus food, and literally right around the corner, there could be a charity that was struggling to raise funding to buy food for those in need. And after a lot of research, we saw that there was a lot more happening internationally, and really saw that there was potential to bring a solution to Ireland. So we looked to technology and developed an app. And the app simply allows a business to upload details of any surplus food that they have, and then it sends a text message out to local charities to let them know what food's available.
Brilliant. And how much food has gone through the cloud, which would have otherwise gone to waste and ended up in people's mouths?
So since we started in October 2013, we've facilitated the redistribution of over 350 tons of food. So that's the equivalent of almost 800,000 meals.
Amazing, and amazing to think that there's that much food waste as well happening every day. Jack, you run the greengrocers on Mead Street. What do you see in terms of waste in your shop and in the markets and in general? There you go.
Well, I suppose, first I'd like to say, I think we're all a bit hypocrites around waste. We pay lip service to it. We, like a gathering here, hopefully we'll be spreading the gospel that waste is out. I've always abhorred waste. I'm in the business all my life. When I go to the market, I'd see stuff, maybe I'd make an offer to buy it, and so, no, they wouldn't have that. They'd, and you know, maybe sell it so good, like sell a reduced rate and somebody else could get the benefit. But you might see it then a couple of days after that just going into a skip. But that was the policy around it. But I'm glad to say I think there is a change there as well. I think hopefully there's a change for all of us that we can realise that where we are and what we need to do. Myself personally, I try to keep it to a minimum. I'm long years in it now, and I try to gear it to have as little as possible by the end. And I would sell it off cheaper, and now Katie has roped me in, so I've become part of her group. And so I even have stuff there in the shop for her to collect in the morning. But so I'm glad to say that I think things are definitely improving along those lines, and it's great to see. And people talking about food, I'll just give you a quick one about food. Of course, being the area of the Liberties, it's a great area for lots of things, including the Guinnesses. But as a woman knew, she only just recently told me this, and her husband, she's a mother, grandmother, and a great-grandmother at a very young age. But as they say, she's a ganzy load of kids. But she was telling me, her husband, Leo, so they're in the pub, and fellas in pubs will talk about anything. And they're talking about potatoes. So one fella said, how do you like your potatoes? Well, see, I like a boiled potato, it's like a roast potato, like chips. And one fella said, I like jacket potatoes. So Leo, Nuala's husband, said he'd never heard of them. Jacket potatoes, he was there. So you get a whole potato and slice it and bake it and put it in the oven and put a bit of mayonnaise and put anything you like on it. So he went home that night and he says to Nuala, the lads in the pub were talking about potatoes. And one fella said, jacket potatoes. She never gave me jacket potatoes. Jacket potatoes, by the time you come home, they're in the pajamas.
Thanks, Jack. That's one to take home. So I want to know, because you're all going to get to taste this later on, free food, free rubbish food. I want to know what you've been making, Jess. Tell us all about it.
Well, I set it off in Galway at about 9:30 this morning at one of the original greengrocers, which is just down the road from Kai. I don't know if you know Galway, you'll know Ernie's. So I was swimming around in their food bin. It was lovely and warm. It smelled like oranges. And young Ernie was like, just skim the top off, you'll be grand, just get in it. And so I started going through it, and in my mind I was like, oh my God, like this is waste. And what was I thinking, that he'd have everything in a box ready for me? And I don't know, it's just the notions that it just connected. Obviously I own a restaurant, so I'm driving home all the time. I weigh my food bins all the time before they go out. But yeah, I just bought some...
Restaurants are incredibly wasteful of food, aren't
hugely,
they?
Hugely, hugely wasteful. I'm lucky enough that I worked for Kevin Thornton when I first came to Ireland, and we used to have our personal bins actually on our bench that he used to go through after every shift. And he'd be like, why are you wasting that? Why are you wasting that? Obviously, I'm from New Zealand, so we got to town probably once every 6 months. So my granny made everything. I wanted to be one of those posh kids that had like beans and tins rather than a big kiln and jar. All I wanted to do was wear track pants, but all the clothes were handmade anyway. Anyway, that's another story. But yeah, I find restaurants hugely wasteful. Obviously, myself and my husband, we have a team of 22 people. So, you know, I work pretty much 14 hours a day, and we're pretty much on top of it now, but, you know, before, I mean, it used to be horrendous.
So what have you made for tonight?
Well, from Sheridan's Cheesemongers in Dublin, in Galway, sorry, I got some beautiful used-by date mascarpone cheese, and I split it with heaps of lemon juice that I found in the bin this morning. And then, obviously, in Galway, just before the winter, we dehydrate all the seaweeds because it's too rough to go out and get them. So I mixed that mascarpone with lemon juice and dried sea lettuce and a bit of garlic just to split it, pretty much like labneh, it's like a Middle Eastern cheese. I made a fresh fennel and apple slaw, and just some chopped salads, really. I mean, it was great working with Katie today in the Fumbly Stables. It was such a great environment, and yeah, it was good. Good fun.
Brilliant. And Katie, what have you made for us?
I wanted to use suppliers that were directly related with Food Cloud, so we used Bretzel Bakery and Nudie Foods, and both of them gave us loads of vegetables and loads of bread. So we ended up with lots of bread and lots of carrots. but I guess we just had to kind of work around that. So we've got lots of crostinis and toast, but we also made this really great burnt bread sauce. So that's you kind of char bread and onions on a skillet, and you add it to a seaweed dashi, and it's just a really nice way to use up really stale bread, stuff that's kind of gone past its date. And then one other thing that we've made is a thing called ashatashi, which is a great little tip that I picked up while working over in San Francisco in a Japanese restaurant, and it's a way of using up all those little greens that are in the back of your fridge, those kind of salad bags where you use half and then you've got the other half and it starts to go a little bit kind of gone and yellow. With all of these greens, whatever's lying around, kale or herbs or salad leaves, You put it into some really hot water and straight away go into ice cold water, and then add some kind of sesame seeds and sesame oil to that. And it's just, it's really fresh and zingy, and it goes bright fluorescent green. So you bring something back that looks like waste. We've also got lots of other bits and pieces. So I hope you enjoy it all later.
Brilliant. I'm starving now. So let's back to the kitchen, get it all organized, and we'll get the panel up. Thank you very much, everybody. Thank you. Running 9 minutes behind, so that's pretty good. I think we've caught up with ourselves. I'm going to introduce the panelists. I'm going to ask them to come up first, and I think I'm going to have to pull over a chair so I can, rather than loom over them, I can sit and join them. And remember, if you're tweeting or if you want to, you know, if anybody's watching online, they can tweet a question, because this is the conversation part of the evening and we want as much as possible to involve all the people in the room and anybody who's watching online and might have questions for this panel, because it's a very interesting panel with a lot of I'm going to be fascinated to hear what these people have to say, having found out a little bit about their backgrounds and where they're coming from and their ideas about the food scene in Ireland. So I have lost my chair. So we've got four very different people. I think the great thing about this conversation is I've been to a lot of food events, and you get the feeling sometimes that it's a little bit of an echo chamber. People are talking to each other. Everybody agrees about what they love about the food world and what they'd like to see outside in the real world. And that's it. It's hard to see how it filters out. So it's great to have people from all different perspectives here to talk about it. And the rules of engagement in this are... it's a conversation. For questions from the floor, this is a safe space for people to say what they want to say as in a civilized a manner as possible. You look like a very civilized audience, so I've no doubt that those rules will be adhered to. So we have Mary Delaney. She lives on a dairy farm in Kilkenny. She is head of horse feeds for Glanbia, but she's not here to talk on behalf of Glanbia. She's here in her capacity as a Nuffield scholar. So she's spent the last few months traveling around the world looking at the dairy industry in places like Australia, New Zealand, Denmark. She's seen how it works in those other countries that we read a lot about. She's seen it at first hand. She's going to be reporting on her what she found in October, so we're hoping to get a bit of a scoop tonight and find out before then. Then we have... we're due to be joined... Oh, yes, Andrew Doyle is here. Fine Gael, TD, Andrew Doyle. Thanks, Andrew. Sorry, I know he was delayed in traffic. Who's the who's chairman of the Doyle Committee on Agriculture. And we have Breda Larkin, who is a comedian and a farmer's daughter from East Galway, and an anthropologist, and has a very interesting take on what's happening on the ground in a part of the country where farming has a very distinct footprint. We have Seamus Sheridan, a cheesemonger, who has taken a market stall in a windy market in Galway and turned it into an international business. And finally, last but not least, we have Roger Schultz, who's the professor of sustainable food from Chagas. So thank you to all the panelists for agreeing to come and coming here and giving up their time. Mary's actually on holiday this week, so she deserves special thanks for coming. I'd like to ask them to, and I'd like to ask you as an audience maybe to do this as well, to put yourselves in a time machine, my time machine. It's a decommissioned Irish water van, so we're all going to climb into it, and we're all going to travel to 2050, and we're going to drive through the heartland of Irish agriculture, and we're going to look out the window, and we're going to say, I'm going to ask the panel, what is it that they would like to see out that window when they look out in 2050 at an Irish farming landscape? And I think I'll start with Mary at the end there.
Hi, good evening, everybody. 2050, the farm that my husband and I farm in Kilkenny has been in his family since the 1700s, and long may it continue. So the family farm structure will still be there in 2050. It's predominant now, and it will continue to be so. the farms of in 2050, as I see them, will be building on the work we've done today. It'll still be the most efficient in the world. We'll still be producing high quality, very sustainable food. The farmers will be using technology that we're talking about today that will be lowering greenhouse gas emissions. We'll be they'll be knowledgeable, they'll be technical, they'll be well educated, and they will be well experienced. They'll be working with their peers across the sector to be and continue to be as sustainable as possible and have a legacy for future generations after that, to be sending, you know, passing the farms on to future generations in an environmentally sustainable, socially sustainable and economically sustainable manner.
Okay, thanks, Mary. And Roger?
Thanks, Catherine. I was delighted when you announced that this would be your question. And as I said, I tore up my original script. There's two reasons why I'm very happy with it. One is that we've actually published our vision for 2050. And it's on our available on our website. And what we see when we look at 2050 is a landscape, in first instance, where every part of the landscape does what it's good at. And that's our way to get making sure that we get the most out of our land. And when I say getting the most out of our land, I don't just mean agriculture. Agriculture or crops or animals is an intrinsic part of that. And I see us producing food that we're good at, that we can produce efficiently, more efficiently than anyone else. But we're also talking about getting the most out of our land in terms of clean water, in terms of sequestering carbon to offset some of our carbon emissions, to produce bioenergy, forestry, to provide a home or even an infrastructure for biodiversity and for our sewage sludge. Now, over the last 2 years, we've done a conceptual modeling, and that's somewhere in between the model that Paul presented and a thought experiment, if you like, where we asked ourselves, do we have enough land in Ireland to deliver all these goods and to meet all these aspirations? And we came up with a qualified answer, and that is, yes, but. Yes, in principle, we have enough land to meet both our food harvest aspirations and our environmental targets. But only if we manage our land to make sure that every part of the landscape does what it's good at. That we use our good soils for producing food, that we use other soils for producing bioenergy or providing a home for biodiversity. Now, we can discuss the intricacies here for the rest of the debate.
Does the EU agree with you, or the EC agree with you on that? Because, you know, there's a suggestion that they're going to tell us that we can't meet those, you know, 300,000 extra cows, that actually we're going to have to reduce our dairy herd and our beef herd. How does that tally with that Chagas idea?
The EU Commission is an enormous institution. On the positive side, we have seen the EU Council, the European Council decision last October, where they agreed with this approach. Also, an indication of the EU interest is that last November, they've awarded us a Horizon 2020 project where we're not only going to apply this science to Ireland, but to all of Europe with 22 European partners. So they're definitely interested. They've given us 5 million to do that, and they're interested in hearing the results. The last point I'd like to make is, what the reason why I'm so happy with 2050 is because there's a lot possible between now and 2050. If you ask about what can be done by 2020, it's very little. But 2050 is 35 years away. If we go back 35 years, we're in 1980, before the internet. So 2050 allows us to look at what can be done, identify the obstacles, identify which ones we can take away, and which ones we can't, and then try and take them away. So I'll leave it at that for now.
Thanks, Roger. And obviously one very serious obstacle to those kinds of growth levels is the milk quota system, which we're a week into being free of. So I think that's obviously going to be a feature of the conversation as well. Breeda, what do you see out the window of the time machine?
Well, I'd like to see lots of trees, really, like, because I know that I think that, you know, really...
Trees won't feed babies in China.
Oh, trees will. Hazelnut trees will. Nut trees, yeah. Well, no, there's lots of trees that, you know, there's, you know, not fruit trees, nut trees that can be harvested very easily in Ireland. Ireland's a very good place to grow nut trees, you know, and lots of variety of nuts. There's hundreds of different varieties of trees and nuts. And, like, I'm worried in small farms, from a small farm, there's a big difference in small farmers and big farmers in Ireland too. And so there's like, I worry that, you know, with the getting rid of ditches, wildlife, all that, the habitat, like the, you know, dairy, I mean, it is a, obviously it's a producer of food and jobs and all that, but it would, I feel like it would ruin this, I've worried that it ruins the soil. I think the soil needs to be taken care of in Ireland. Like, I'd love to see a future where, yes, people can have dairy and things, but there should be forests left, you know, and soil development where, you know, because it's the golden brown, you know, for more food, better food. Ireland could be a great food producer, local 5 mile foods, all that sort of thing. So I'd love to see small farmers being allowed support to grow food for their local communities and stuff like that. So there would be, that's what I'd like to see in 2050. And yeah.
And you're optimistic that that's what you will see if you looked out the window in 2050?
Yeah, well, there's a lot of, like in my area at home, there's lots of old farmers that, you know, bachelors, they just happen to be all bachelors where, you know, there's no one to take over the farm. You know, there's a whole generation gone. They're gone, went to the construction industry, now they're gone to Australia digging for gold and whatnot, you know. So there's like, there is a real, you know, that small farming communities could die off, and then, you know, whoever buys the land could fell the ditches or anything like that. You know, there needs to be, people need to take responsibility for their own community to keep thriving. And yeah, there's lots of different varieties of food you can grow. There's not just milk, you know, there's, you know, a hemp is a good one to grow, isn't it? Chagas have hemp, or anything like that, you know, it grows easy. You know, it can produce everything, it can produce milk, so it can produce, you know, so there's lots of, and seeds and food and everything. So, yeah, food is very varied. So that's kind of, I like a variety, a sort of a, you know, biodiversity, that would be great, yeah.
Okay. Andrew, what are you seeing out the window?
I wouldn't mind being still around, but anyway, yeah. Well, I suppose if we work on the basis that there's not going to be any more land produced, if anything, there'll be more of a constraint on land that can produce food because of a scarcity of water, competing with human demand on it. And that if we take it as a global effort, that the world's population is meant to increase, so anywhere that can produce food efficiently should do it. So I suppose, well, going back to what Roger said, every square metre of land should be doing what it does best and most efficiently and sustainably. So if you just take a very simple figure, there are approximately 2 million hectares of grassland in this country. 500,000 of it's dedicated at the moment to dairy, and that will increase, but probably not as much as some people think, because there has to be organic growth through improvement and improved efficiency in how milk is produced, so that each litre of milk or kilo of butterfat is produced using less greenhouse gas emissions. The other 1.5 million that produces dry stock is probably quite inefficient in the main. A lot of it would be better used with something else on it, be that forestry, bioenergy crops, whatever. And I think you will see a shift even in this last round of CAP, where Pillar 1 money is now has a 30% greening element, that more and more the cap itself will be more about public good than it will be about price support. So,
but there is a perception that public policy, especially at the moment, is geared up towards big food, towards big dairy production. Is that something that you...
Well, if you take the previous Agriculture Commissioner Sholas's outline of when he published the draft CAP plan, it was to produce as much food in Europe as possible, to do so sustainably, and to protect rural communities. So if you base the whole
principle... Is that because that's what
gives
the market
an edge,
wants?
That gives an edge to the smaller family farm structure that we have in Europe, as opposed to what happens in the Argentine, to a lesser extent New Zealand, though it's getting there, it is getting there, Australia and America, where you just have really, you know, not multinational, but conglomerates running farms. And it's just purely, purely business. So there's no social dimension. You have animal welfare issues, environmental issues, and social issues, all
affected. But is that not the road we could go down?
We could, but we have...
If public policy doesn't...
We have the... No, I think the policy at the moment is actually... is trying to... There will be certainly consolidation, you know. I mean, when I think it was Poland joined the EU, they probably had of the order of 10 million farmers. They'll probably end up with 5 million, and the average size of them will be a lot smaller than Ireland. So you have to take everything in context. But the point I would make is that there is no point in us... We could reduce our percentage emissions simply by cutting production. Or we could do it by increasing heavy industry production if Volkswagen decided to put a manufacturing plant here. But does that achieve anything on a global level? The question has to be asked, what's the global gain in actually reducing just to achieve a simple percentage? There's lies, damn lies, and statistics. So I just feel that we have to be careful that what we do is everything is in the best interest of the global effort to reduce carbon. Because to be honest, we have to produce food. We will see proteins, wheat germ, grown in tanks. There's no doubt about it. We'll see protein grown on seaweed, on water paper, suspended in tanks. You know, huge volumes of it to supplement feed for animals. But you're still going to have animals. And there's an argument that a cow grazing grass is actually a very efficient utiliser of carbon.
But the Irish cows are not just grazing grass.
They're getting there.
They're not just grazing grass anymore. I mean,
they're not.
Why do farmers have grain silos on their farms now? I mean, the Irish grass-fed scene is changing very significantly because farmers are under pressure to produce yields that cannot be produced on grass.
Well, if you listen to people like from Positive Farmers, say, who would say you have to have... New Zealand has gone to a grass... I don't want to bore people. Grass, poor diet. You have to have a grass-rich diet. But just producing food all the time from grass alone is not necessarily the most efficient use. You're producing a milk that has been described as white urine. It's not actually very good for processing, you know. Just purely off grass in the month of May and June. It's been described as that by some. Now, I'm beside a cheesemonger who's much more expert on this than I am. But if you want an animal to produce milk over a lactation period, sometimes it's much more efficient to include some balancing, like yeast, for instance, you know, into a diet that actually makes the animal's rumen function much better.
So there are lots of ways.
Lots of technical stuff here, but
there are lots of ways of changing the fundamentals of the cow.
Your bottom line is, whether it's a kilo of milk, a kilo of meat, a kilo of butterfat, or a litre of milk, can it be produced using less carbon, emitting less greenhouse gases in Ireland by improving knowledge and technology and embracing herd health and grassland management? All that is so important. But by just simply not doing it here, do we end up letting it be produced somewhere else, bearing in mind against the backdrop that the population is growing on the planet? And I don't think we're going to stop that happening.
Seamus, what do you see out the window?
What I see at the window is a gorgeous sunset over Galway. I'm from here. I grew up around the corner. My back lane was the dividing wall between Arragaff and Windsor Terrace Slaughterhouse. So I grew up until the age of 13 with a full understanding of belching cows and shit and the realities of farming. But if I want to look to 50 years, I'm going to go leave Dublin and go back to where I live now in Galway, where the sun is setting. And in 50 years' time, if I'm trying to be positive, what I'd like to see on the west coast of Ireland would be fantastic on-land facilities where we've embraced aquaculture, because fish float and they don't fart. So if we're trying to provide protein for the globe, aquaculture is probably the way to go. The only problem at the moment is we are kind of taking 3 kilos of wild fish for every 1 kilo of farm fish at the moment, but there are very brainy guys up in NUIG and over in Kentucky, and they're closely looking at the genome of algae, which is a source of fish oils. So in 50 years' time, I think we could have a fantastic, sustainable source of protein on the West Coast using fermented algae, using our fresh, clean salt water, and leaving behind a wonderful protected marine environment with just inshore fishing, which will be supporting one of the most popular tourist destinations on the planet in 50 years' time, because we won't have fecked it up. Now, moving a bit inland onto Galway, I'd like to see tens of miles of of greenhouses outside our city, where we've embraced aerobic anaerobic digestion and power production, utilizing our wind and utilizing our city's waste, and growing so much vegetables with underground water-heated pipes. But not like they did in Holland in the 70s. We are going to be much smarter, and we're going to embrace biodiversity and different strands of different plants year by year. And outside our greenhouses, we're going to have plants and bees and everything. And even outside that, we're still going to have Germans with small organic farms, because we love them too. It's all going to work. So further on in, up along the coast, down to Clare and Galway, I'm going to see beautiful herds of Moyne cattle and Dexters and Kerry cows, and along with our black-faced mountainy lambs, and we're going to have very small farms in those beautiful green fields, and they're going to be working together to get the premium they deserve, and chefs like Jess, who's here from Kai, who's already doing it, will be paying that extra couple of quid per pound to get really good meat locally sourced. But that's everyone, and all the restaurants are going to be doing it. That's going to be fantastic, and even more tourists are going to be coming. It gets more difficult now when I'm coming east. So we're into East Galway. I would like to see that the towns that have been decimated in East Galway by, well, we all love it, all my family are in one-off housing, that's going to stop, and our farmers are going to move back into our little towns and support each other and shop locally. And within that, we're going to see a modern Irish agriculture that is embracing science, that is embracing plant science, embracing technology, and looking at how much we can produce on this island without necessarily having too much imports of grain and feeds that you talked about earlier. And that's very interesting. And then emerging as we come further east, we're going to see agricultural co-ops working together. And instead of producing the very base commodity item that we produce in Ireland, we are going to see our farmers producing meat and cheese like they do in France and Switzerland and other places around the world, that you can actually get more than 29 feckin' cent for a litre of milk, turning that into something that is worthwhile for our farmers. And then closer on up to Dublin, we're going to have an embrace market gardening and vegetable production, because they're going to be copying how successful Galway was. And then right up into our city, we're going to have our universities all working together, embracing science. We're going to stop the polarization between genetic engineering, plant science, and the environmentalists. They're all going to be working together for the benefit of social justice and mankind. And we're going to have our farming organizations and our politicians proud that Ireland has embraced the environment and sustainable food production. And we won't have any people saying we have to produce more meat to feed the world. We'll realize that we're very lucky and very blessed in Ireland to be able to produce the meat that we do, but we totally respect the damage that global meat production is doing throughout the globe. And our farming representatives, the IFA and the ICMSA and the Department of Agriculture, will not just be representing farmers here in Ireland, but we'll be known throughout the world as a country that respected and fought for the agriculture rights of not just Irish farmers, but all farmers around the world, realizing that our farmers today are in the 0.01 richest farmers on the planet. Thank you.
Thank you.
So how do we achieve that? No, I'm not going to ask you another question, Seamus. Mary, can I ask you, which of the many countries you visited impressed you the most in how they're producing milk?
I travelled to countries that I thought had similar setups to Ireland. So I was in New Zealand, and in Ireland the average dairy farm is 65 cows. They're talking about it growing to 80, but in New Zealand you're looking at 400. And really, one of the things I learned when I came back is how good we do it in Ireland, how good we have it in Ireland. They have serious challenges. They have drought. They're having to irrigate the land. They're getting, you know, the nutrient quality problems. They're getting the equivalent of a nitrates directive coming at them, which we have had for a number of years. So I see challenges there that in Ireland, like, we can thank ourselves and thank the blessings that we are operating under nitrates directive. We are
we still have the second highest use of artificial fertilizer in Europe. That's not a very proud position to be in, really, is it?
We're operating under, you know, the EU Nitrates Directive. We're farming in a very efficient manner. We have the lowest carbon footprint in the world, and we're working on improving it. We are already auditing every farm in Ireland. We're working on it. We're working on continuous improvement. We know we've a lot of work to do. When I went to the Netherlands, I was very impressed by the collaboration and how they communicated the challenge that is climate change with their farmers, and I think we can take a lot of learnings from that. And it's why I took part and did the Nuffield Scholarship, because I think there is a huge challenge around climate change and dairy expansion. Like, we want to pass our farm on to the next generation. We want to farm in as efficient a manner as possible. We want to do everything we can. We want to embrace science, embrace technology. When I went to New Zealand, they were raving about Chagas here, like the work that they're doing. They were raving about Irish agriculture. In the Netherlands, it was the same. I heard so much positivity. I came back very positive about our structure. But we're not home and hosed. We're out of the gates first, but we have a huge amount to do. And there's a lot of work involved around communicating the challenge. And that's why I'm so glad to be here, I suppose, to give the farmers' perspective, to share some of what I've learned on my travels, but recognising that we have a huge amount more to do.
Do you think that an Irish farmer today, looking at where their future lies, is feeling under pressure to grow their farm, to become a big farmer? There is a pressure there in terms of the market, in terms of the idea that, you know, we're feeding the 9 billion, that you can't really be a small farmer. You can't really make a living as a small farmer in Ireland anymore.
I think that our next quota is land, the availability of suitable land. And I think so that's going to, you know, be a huge challenge in terms of any expansion. And that's a problem across Ireland. Like Irish people, and it's another thing I found when I came back, is that we love the land. We're proud farmers. We're proud of our farms. I didn't see that to the same extent in any other market. And with that comes the challenge that you're not willing to give it to another farmer to expand. So that is a challenge. But I do see excitement among dairy farmers about the opportunity to utilise their land to the best potential. Like, we have stopped our beef cattle now because we are now farming dairy only because we now have the opportunity to do so. So we don't have an increase in numbers, but we are farming as efficiently as possible and doing it to the best of our ability. And again, we've a lot to learn and we need to work together, we need to collaborate. I spoke to a huge number of stakeholders and NGOs, and I really am beginning to understand the, you know, the climate change challenge. And I now I'm in a position where I can make informed choices, and I hope to share that in my report. But, you know, farmers in Ireland want to protect their land. They want to have a viable business to pass on. And, you know, our challenge is land availability for growth.
And Roger, can I just ask you, you were talking about almost mapping the country and the land to figure out what works best in what parts of the country. Obviously, that's a perfect solution if you own all the land. But, you know, how do you persuade, you know, what level of intervention is required to tell a farmer, this is what we need you to grow because this is what your land does best? And is the knowledge there about what the land does best in order to allow that to happen?
Then that's two questions, Catherine. The first question is the knowledge there. We're getting there. We now, for the first time, have a full comprehensive soil map of the country. And we're beginning to map not only the agricultural suit. We're beginning to map not only the agricultural suitability, but also the other ecosystem services, the supply of those across the country. Now, how do we manage that? That is the most important question that we need to figure out. Because what nobody wants is some sort of command and control economy where each farmer is told what to grow or what to do with their land. But that's not necessarily.
But if we're talking about Ireland as being the milk bowl of the world, which is what Andrew's laying out, you know, we do it well here, let's do it, then effectively that is what you're telling farmers. You're telling them that, you know, we are going to have to turn the landscape into one large pasture to feed the world with milk. I mean, is that not what that argument brings us to?
There's two extremes of the argument. On the one hand, if your objective is solely to minimize the greenhouse gases associated with food, if that is your only one objective, then every country would produce the food that it can produce most efficiently and you would trade. Food miles are overrated. There are exceptions. When you fly beans in an airplane, there is exceptions. But overall, food miles are a tiny proportion of greenhouse gas emissions. However, if you take it to the extreme and you only would produce milk in Ireland and only produce rice in the Po Valley or whatever, you are ultimately going to eat into your resilience, which is another aspect of the climate change debate. If you have one farm system only, then if a shock comes to that farm system, you struggle to deal with it. So on the other side of the scale is diversity, and diversity of farms, diversity of types, and like Seamus said, organic farms next to high-tech farms, next to another type of farm. And somewhere there, we have to find a balance between doing what we're good at, and at the same time fostering that diversity.
But at the moment, the main driver of what seems to be happening in Irish agriculture, from an outsider's perspective, which is what I have, is that it's the market. It's the Chinese consumer, it's the West African consumption of milk powder. It is a growing middle class in China where there is an amazing, phenomenal project to encourage people who never drank milk to now drink milk. And that is where all of this extra Irish milk is going. So that is such a huge force in the world and in the Irish agricultural scene. As we keep saying, we're quite a small player in this, even though we produce a phenomenal amount of meat and dairy. How do you manage to not let the market decide what happens to our land?
That's a very good question. And the question is, do you want the market not to decide? First of all, two things. First of all, there's one global food system. It isn't the case that unless we export food to Africa, that we're not contributing to food security. It's all one food system. If we don't supply China with milk, somebody else will, and ultimately that will be at the expense of other countries.
Is that a good enough argument to be part of that?
Pardon?
Is that a good enough argument to be part of what is using milk as a tool for economic growth? It's filling a human nutrition for need, or a human need for nutrition that isn't actually there. It's creating a market demand.
If you move into that discussion, then it's important that we separate the livestock produce into three different groups. There's dairy, there's ruminants, so beef and sheep, and then there's monogastrics. And rather than having one debate over what livestock produce is desired and where it is desired, we need to have three debates. First of all, dairy is recognized as a nutritious food product where there is a need for humans to consume dairy as part of a varied diet. Secondly, we have the monogastrics, the pigs and the poultry, who are far more efficient in turning plant protein into animal protein. The problem with them is they compete for human crops. They use the same inputs as we do. So they compete for land. And then we have the ruminants, which are far less efficient. They use a lot of water, they belch a lot of methane, but they have one trick. They can convert inedible proteins that we can't eat into something that's edible.
Feeding them human food as well, aren't we?
Not in Ireland. I think we can be very proud in Ireland that we stand out as the country that has the highest proportion of grass, together maybe with New Zealand. And one third of the world is covered by grassland that is not suitable for crops. The last country that did an experiment with plowing up grasslands was the United States. And we know what happened there to the Great Dust Bowl. So we have partners in Wageningen University, and they did another thought experiment. They said, how can we feed the world and at the same time minimize the amount of land and environmental resources that we need? And what would the diet look like? If there's a low population, then the intake of animal protein would actually be very low. You would still need animal produce to use the crop residues that we can't eat. But as the population increases and you've used up all your arable land, you're going to have to use your marginal land, your grasslands. And as you do that, the proportion of animal protein in our diets would actually increase. Now, there's a big difference between our diets in the West and the diets in other parts of the world, and there's room for a significant adjustment. But that brings me full circle to your last question, which is the difficulty of the market, because of course there's a complete disconnect between our consumption in Ireland and our production. Even if the whole of Ireland went vegetarian in the morning, it'd make no difference to Irish agriculture, because we export 90%. So that's a long-winded answer to a simple question.
Great. Breda, you want to farm your family farm in East Galway. What are your plans for it? Are they animal-based or plant-based?
Well, no, I mean, I'm going around door to door trying to convince farmers to go organic, really. I think it's the only way that they'll survive, like small farmers. Because, I mean, my father, I've watched him have a small farm, and the price of a lamb is the same now as it was in 1971. I mean, it's just, you know, the price of meat for the farmer is not, I mean, really do not get what it's worth, you know.
And what do farmers say when you say organic is the way out of that low-income lifestyle? What reaction do you get to that?
They have lots of questions for me, and I also am finding the questions, you know, I'm finding the answers for them. Because it's transition happening, because they're like in their 60s, 70s, even 80s now. The word organic wouldn't be in their dictionary that much, you know. But at the same time, you know, there is a lot more crops and growth. I mean, I do really think that, you know, the milk, while it would be, it's not the only thing that has calcium. I mean, you know, green vegetables, much better calcium. But at the same time, I think people are convinced that it is real healthy, more healthy than it actually is, really. You know, a lot of people are... it can be other options. I think there should be, you know, because I think the small farmer with the beef has gone, if you drive them into dairy, then the bottom will fall out of that eventually as well, you know, because there's too much, I think there's just too many cattle. And, you know, I really think that's what happened, the quantity instead of quality, you know, that you had the more cattle per headage and everything like this. So you have, and, you know, so just, I think, you know, just a really, the farming in Ireland should just be, we discussed more what can be biodiversity, definitely. Like, what can you actually grow?
I mean, the argument is made that we do cows well. Cows are our specialised subject. How do you... Is it just we do things as they've been done? Is it a generation of people who are used to doing things like that?
I think it is a bit tradition, because cattle are fed... The feed is very expensive. The feed comes from big corporate companies. You know, I mean, you've got lots of people using like Roundup and all sorts of pesticides and everything. I mean, the landscape, if you continue to stretch out land and make it beautifully for grass, I mean, what about the trees or the plants or any of the wildlife? They'll just be sort of... People use pesticides very willy-nilly in Ireland. Like, really, it's see all on the side of the road... Brown, if you look at yellow grass, it's all Roundup, and you know, it's a really, it should be banned, I think, anyway, because I mean, I don't like it, but thank you. Yeah, there's bigger issues at stake, you know, for people's health, and I do think the food, we shouldn't look at what we can make money from. I know it's important to do in an economy, fair enough, you know, but what we can actually keep people healthy as well. I mean, there's a great quote, don't go to the doctor to get, you know, make you better, go to the farmer to keep you healthy, you know, pay the farmer to keep you healthy. So there is, you know, some support there to grow better food for us all.
Andrew, I'm kind of conscious that I'm keep bouncing questions back, so I think if anybody wants to jump in and, you know, just have a conversation amongst yourselves. But Andrew, are you optimistic about the direction of Irish farming?
I think the first thing is, you asked earlier, does everybody have to get just be driven by expansion? But we committee I chair just did a report on managing market volatility, just simply on the dairy sector, and a line which we borrowed actually from one of the banks, which was subsequently used by Sharon Neviolan on RTE, was bigger, better before bigger. It gets better at what you do first before you get bigger, because bigger is only going to land you in trouble with the banks. It's as simple as that. If you're sitting, as I am, a farmer who came home from New Zealand actually in 1983, living up in near Glendalough, in where there's plenty of land that's not going to be overutilized or over-fertilized or anything else. And if you look at the total landscape of County Wicklow just, and the country, there's balance there. And we've never done a total land use calculation. So one can balance the other. Grass is a carbon sequester. Minimum tillage, min-till tillage is actually minimal in tillage. You don't expose carbon in the same way that deep ploughing does, and it's tradition. And you can see there are people out there, agronomists, who actually will show you landscape in floodplains, whereby using min-till or no-till systems, you can actually mitigate flooding. There's a lot of things that can be done to actually improve the environment, the natural environment, and build on what we have. So I think what we need is a total land use policy, as opposed to just a food policy, or an environmental policy, or a recreation policy, or a renewable energy policy. We need a land use policy. And let's calculate everything. We did a report last November, which took a while. Roger was one of the people who came in to us on maximizing or land use maximizing its potential. And that's not just about producing food. That's about the bigger picture. And let's put Ireland's position up there and let's say measure up to that, or how do we measure up to the others? And let's see it. Like New Zealand, I went back a few years ago and I couldn't believe it. They had dammed, put Lake Dunstan up, which was a dam on the Clutha River, and there was where the Mackenzie country, which was pristine South Island, sort of semi-arid land, but beautiful. And they pivot irrigators, pumping out 2 inches of water on top of land. And now they're running into all sorts of, Catherine has said, all sorts, or Mark, sorry, Mary has said, all sorts of environmental difficulties. And they've gone grass poor.
But isn't that a symptom of intensive agriculture? When we say our artificial fertilizer use is very high, New Zealand's is world topping. So effectively they have grown a swath of grass with a root system of about that. So any climate shock, like the drought, suddenly the unthinkable happens. I mean, what if the unthinkable happens in Ireland and it stops raining? Our heavily artificially fertilised grassland has how many weeks before we're in another fodder crisis situation?
I mean, if that was to happen, we'd have to everything would be back to the basics, like back to the drawing board. But if you even take the system, I went out in 1981, I think it was, to New Zealand, because they were the kings of grassland management, and they based a crop their grassland management over keeping the grass at the right level for an animal to graze it, using red clover to fix nitrogen through photosynthesis, as opposed to having to put out a bag. They put out superphosphate to balance the minerals, and they put out lime where it was necessary. That was all was ever put out. 8 years ago, they were going out with can, and they had sheds for cattle. I said, what's going on here? You know, totally. And I said, these are moving in the wrong direction, and it's going to stop. And we actually have moved.
And what pulled them in that direction?
They thought there were, look, there's two models that you could use, north of Ireland and New Zealand. One beside us on the same type of soil, where people produce a lot more milk by using fertilizer and cereal feeds, basically, but they're not making any more money, and it's pointless. Like, they could do a little less. They could improve by managing the grass, the animal health, and their diets better.
So this is the Northern Ireland situation, where only 1% of the herd are actually on grass, the rest are in sheds.
Well, I forget the figures, but the amount of milk that they're producing now, liquid milk, because basically they've had no quota since 2005, since the UK, mainland Britain, that is, actually gave up milk production, fresh milk production. And now they're probably contributing 20-25% of our fresh milk. And there's an irony in all of that, that actually if the UK says we're running out of fresh milk, we want to take that from the north, we could actually end up a country that's exporting 80%, 85% of the milk product we produce having no fresh milk. It's scary in a way. And just to make the point, only 8% of the world's milk production is traded internationally. The biggest single producer of milk on the planet is India. And India is now moving to a position where it may have to import milk. It's not a very efficient producer in some ways. And then again, it is in others. I mean, it's if you wanted consolidation, the average herd size is probably 3, you know. We've 65, New Zealand has 400. just to put it in context.
Seamus.
This is about climate change, this gathering. We could all look to the future in the next 10 years of a brilliant sustainable and economic model for Irish agriculture mixed with tourism. I can see it. When I factor in climate change, it gets very difficult even in my own head. I get kind of confused. But I think there are solutions, and if you go along... Okay, I was very positive last time. There's scary stuff going on as well. A lot of what I dealt with in the last 10 years is disease and antibiotic resistance and zoonotic transfer disease. That's big words. Campylobacter, Listeria, MRSA, particularly in our animal herds. This comes with the intensification of production. It's one of the greatest threats we have, not just for our human race, but also for our animal herds. And we don't know what to do with it. There is a little bright chink, and it's coming from plant science and our understanding of the genome project, that one teaspoon of soil has more organisms than there are people on the planet in one teaspoon of soil. Isn't that mind-blowing? And our understanding of soil and how we can treat soil is probably the one thing that we have at our advantage. We have to stop consuming globally the amount of meat we're consuming. This idea that I keep hearing on the radio that Ireland has somehow got this altruistic, we're just here to feed the world. No, we're not. We're here to make cash. Myself and my brother are here to make cash by exporting Irish food. We're not trying to save the world or feed the world. It's a load of nonsense. If you want to feed the world, eat good food, many plants, as Michael Pollan said, okay? So let's call a spade a spade. But in somehow, if we're talking about climate change in this meeting, there is a mathematical equation of looking at the inputs we could create sustainably within our own island. And what you said was very correct. I love the story of, like, food miles. Say in England, in Norfolk, which is brilliant to grow potatoes, but if you grow potatoes closer to London, it takes more energy. So that's very important that areas nationally do what they do best. But I don't agree that areas globally should do what they do best. We've also got a problem that in agriculture, and you can see it being a farmer, we've got a minister for agriculture who's brilliant and all that, but he's representing farmers and processors. So we've got big processors. But hold on, I have to finish this. We have got huge processors who want quantity at the lowest price to turn into processed foods to sell to the poorest people on this planet at an exorbitant price. And then on the other side, we've got farmers who want to produce less at a higher price. So I think it's time that we had a minister for farming and that the big food processors and the small ones went into trade and industry. But these are political things. But speaking on climate change, I'm worried about disease and I'm worried about pollution. I'm worried about fertilizer. When you said that Ireland is the highest use of fertilizers, that's true. But other countries in the continent, they have feedlots. And they're because they're importing feed from South America, if you looked at the amount of fertilizer they're using for their feed, it would be much worse than in Ireland. And I just leave with this, and I keep saying it again, that it's time we stopped looking at ourselves and look at the labor conditions and the social justice issues that farmers all over the globe, whether it's in aquaculture, fish farming, or producing grain, the appalling conditions and the appalling environmental disaster that has been created in the developing world to feed this massive need we have for cheese and for meat. And we really have to cup onto ourselves globally. That's what I'm saying.
Thanks, Jim.
I'm going to take questions from the audience now, but I just want to finish with a line that I've stolen from one of Peter Fallon's poems. It's a poem called, sorry, I'm just getting rid of that mic before it gets horrible noise. It's a poem called Late Sentinels, and I think it says as much about climate change as it does about agriculture, and it's just a line. It says, as if there were no end to plenty, we plundered earth. And I think the question here tonight is there an end to the plenty? And if so, how do we avoid that situation where we feel like, you know, the decisions that were made today have
terrible consequences for future generations. Do we have any questions from... Yeah.
It's less a question than a statement. Just to identify a gap, as I saw it in the conversation, Paul opened up with talking about emissions solely. It's like speaking about breathing, but only speaking about exhaling. There's two sides to the carbon cycle. The carbon cycle is immensely important in the soil under the ground. The capacity of our soils to absorb the carbon that we have released since the Industrial Revolution into the atmosphere is immense. If every acre in the world could increase its carbon percentage by 1%, it would put all the oil that we have put into the atmosphere back into the ground again, where it should have been in the first place. We talk about ruminants, and there's this debate goes on about, oh, if we didn't eat meat and we didn't eat cheese, and if we all were vegetarians, what a wonderful world it would be. Immediately, the bovine was not adapted to pollute the planet. The bovine was adapted to feed grasslands. That's what she is adapted to do by nature. She has an inefficient digestive system so as to allow those nutrients to be passed back into the soil to feed the soil. If you put bovines onto soil, onto grassland and soil, you increase the carbon matter in the soil. If you plow it and produce vegetables, you decrease the carbon matter in the soil. This is people shaking their heads. Google when you go home, Alan Savory. His research into desertification in Rhodesia 25 years ago now, he was sent out with a brief, prove that overgrazing is what causes desertification. He came back with a solution. He said, before a man came to Africa and started shooting all the ruminants, the prairies were perfectly healthy. The same goes for North America, the same goes for everywhere. I'm sorry for going on a little bit. I am a farmer. I define myself for the last 10 years as a carbon farmer. Before that, I was a science teacher. I watched from when I started teaching, carbon being 0.03%. When I finished teaching, it's 0.04%. That's a 33% increase in a very key factor of our environment in my lifetime. I had 100 acres of land. I decided to put it to the purpose of locking up as much carbon as I can through forestry and through a system of grazing called holistic grazing management. So that's my contribution. I felt there was nothing said about the importance of soil and its ability to actually save us from what could be down the line.
Thank you. Any questions?
I have something to say. Hello, good afternoon. I'm not a farmer, I'm an artist, I'm a landscape painter. And the we're not the only species that use the landscape. And I'm particularly concerned about the hen harrier and then archaeological sites and actually tourism, environmentally friendly tourism, can use a lovely, clean, healthy landscape in Ireland. I observe the landscape very closely, and I just have two little warnings for you. The Chinese in Oriental physiognomy, or however you pronounce that, can't actually absorb milk, cow's milk. They can have mother's milk and maybe other kinds of milk, but you're going to have to change the actual makeup of milk to sell it to the Chinese. And then the other thing is, with more carbon in there, green growth loves carbon. And you probably noticed over the last few summers, trees and grass and clover absolutely flourishes to a huge bulk, but it only takes in about a third of the amount of nutrients. It's battling against the nutrients. So the more carbon in the atmosphere, the more inedible is the green matter that's growing, lapping up all that carbon. It'll have fewer and fewer nutrients. One lovely comment to the lady at the end, the farmer who's been farming for the last few centuries on the same land. There's a place in Kerry, your family has. there's a place in Kerry where the sort of minor cager fields, not quite as old as the cager fields, these field systems underneath the bog, they're from the Bronze Age. But the farmer who actually, whose land is in that valley, can point up to that valley and proudly say that he's been protecting and farming, or farmers like himself, for the last 2,500 years. So it's the farmers who actually protect the landscape, and may they keep doing so.
Absolutely, very good point. Any questions,
My name is Charles Stanisworth from Antashka. Antashka are always accused of being against everything. And you may remember back in the old days before the housing bubble, we actually preached against that. And we now see a milk bubble coming at us all. A few things I'd like to say. We started off the day here with some stuff about the greenhouse gas emissions. Well, sorry, about the energy use of agriculture. It didn't actually really refer to greenhouse gas emissions, which aren't dropping. Energy use may be good. We're actually importing our food. We have a positive food energy import into this country. If you include all the energy required for the nitrates and the like. So that's one thing. And there is no attempt where we've shown where the methane and so on was going to be reduced so that Ireland can meet its greenhouse gas targets. We are already being told by the EU just recently that instead of having a 20% reduction by 2020, we're currently bloody lucky to hit 3. So we're wildly missing our targets already without any effect of added stuff from greenhouse gases from agriculture. So does that mean the rest of us are going to have to go overboard in reducing in terms of transport, heating, and the like for ourselves to allow these farmers export and make money? Well, the rest of us have to pay. Is there no mechanism in this? And it hasn't been said that in terms of this agriculture, what we're going to bring in, we're going to actually offset some of the rest of the stuff for you. We're going to pay for you, help you achieve better houses and all of that. None of this has been said. It's just out there. Well, let's feed the world.
I think Paul's figures really sum that up. The question of, if we're not going to reduce agricultural emissions, where are we going to reduce them? Is there somebody on the panel who would like to address that question?
Very quickly, the point the gentleman made over there is in some ways correct, but that study was looking at saving land, the de-desertification of land, particularly in the savanna plains. Yes, grazing is a very, very good method of milk production. Nobody's disagreeing with that. But what we have to do in Ireland is to look at how much cattle we can have and use the grass we have. We cannot increase our herd if it means importing inputs from the developing world just to make money here in Ireland. But I totally agree with you. But it's not as simple as you said. And for the lady said with the hen harrier, look, I hate listening to Pat Kenny or on News Talk and farmers ringing up going, the hen harrier, infect them, what are they doing? They're killing us, okay? Tourism and the environment, or the environmental value of what we have in Ireland, is worth billions of pounds more than agriculture is. Billions, okay? And we need some respect from farming organisations to mind our environment along with creating their own living. And I think I agree with that gentleman. We are not really addressing the overall emissions that we're having from our meat production. And I think it's too simplistic to say that if everybody ate vegetables. That's not what I'm saying. I'm involved in cheese. You're involved in farming. I'm the same as you. I'm just saying we need to get the right price and the right respect and the right value for what we're doing.
I think Roger and Mary want to come in on this and the question of, if we don't get the emissions from agriculture, where are we going to get them? Or the emissions reductions?
Yeah, the first point I'd like to make is that the current way that we count for emissions, both in agriculture but also at national level, the rules run up to 2020. The world has agreed on a set of rules, the second Kyoto commitment period, up to 2020, and that's the rules we have to play by. At the moment, both the Commission and the UNFCCC at world level and the European Commission at European level are in a period of consultation of what we want to see after 2020, how we count for our emissions. Now, the world agreement is meant to be decided in Paris in December. And there's a lot of people talking at the moment on a new set of rules. One of the issues relating to agriculture is that the agricultural emissions in the current rule set are accounted for in a very strange way. It's split over two sectors. We have an agricultural sector, and we've got what's called a land use change and forestry sector, LULUCF. It's cut in those two sectors. That does strange things with how we deal with agriculture. And remember, Kyoto was originally designed, and the rules of Kyoto were designed for industry and for energy. And agriculture was brought in as an afterthought. What it means is that currently, under the current rules, we only count the bad emissions from agriculture. Okay? We only count the methane, the nitrous oxides, and the carbon dioxide. All the good aspects that agriculture can have, the forestry, the bioenergy production, the storage of carbon in the soil, currently are lumped into the LULUCF sector, which has no owners. It's kind of the change in the pocket. Now, what we are proposing for in our discussions is a merging, an integrated approach, so that we count both the good and the bad. The purpose of doing that is not to get a free ride. The purpose is that it gives us more levers. It gives us more levers for incentives. It gives us more levers for change. It brings in the forestry discussion into agriculture. It brings bioenergy into agriculture. And because only when we get credit for change can we incentivize change. So that is my first answer. While I have the microphone, may I make one other point that I think is important in terms of our credentials in terms of food security? Because there's two aspects to it. One aspect is the commercial aspect, and we live in a global food system. But the other aspect is also an ethical aspect. And I just want to make a point that may be not very well known, that the agricultural sector is actually very proactive in the ethical side of it as well, and the altruistic debate. In Chagask, we started five years ago, a program with Ethiopia, where we're working with Ethiopian research institutes to work on sustainable farming systems. We're working with a lot of Irish NGOs. We're working with Irish Aid. We're working with Irish NGOs such as Vita, but also Goethe. And many of those NGOs have their roots and their main support base in the agricultural community. And there's few sectors in Ireland that are more proactive in the altruistic food security than the agricultural sector. And I think it's only fair that we pay credit to that. We have two members, I think, from MACRA in the audience who are very helpful with our project in Ethiopia, who work, MACRA is the Young Farmers Association in Ireland, and they are working directly with the young Ethiopian farmers to upskill them in their food security challenges. So I just want to make that point. That is a fair question. The short answer is yes.
We need the mic. The question was about peatlands and taking them into account. If there is some kind of trade-off between agricultural and forestry emissions, as I understood it.
Sorry. The question is: are we taking peat into account? And it's a very good question, because we stumbled upon that ourselves when we looked beyond 2020 in this new accounting method, where if we want to account for the carbon that we're storing in the soil, we also have to account for the carbon that we're losing from degraded peatlands. Now, and the challenge with degraded peatlands is the change in management has largely been made, the sheep population has, since the decoupling has plummeted on the peatlands, but unfortunately those degraded peatlands keep releasing carbons for decades on end, and we just have to wait that out. Now, according to our very rough calculations, they undo up to about a third of the carbon that we're sequestering in our soils is undone by loss from degraded peatland. So we have taken that into account, into our calculation. We have to take the bad with the good.
We have another question?
Yeah, sorry, thanks. Very quick question. First of all, I suppose in response to what you've just said in regards to the overall efficient use of land, I agree that the intention would not be to create a free ride. I think the ultimate outcome would be that it would create a free ride economically for those who wanted to just massively increase production. Sorry, my two questions were just one. First is going back to the first speaker from UCC who said about special situations. I'd like to just go back to that. How is Ireland different from, for example, Poland? Poland is particularly good at producing coal. It can produce coal particularly effectively when compared to, for example, China. However, the mathematics say that if Poland extracts more than about 15-20% of its coal reserves, we're going to blow our 2050 target. If the world continues its demand for beef and dairy at the rate that it's currently increasing, we're going to blow our 2050 targets. So how, we've talked about supply, how do we, at a global level, look to try and control demand, and what's the best way of doing that? And the second one is in relation to adaptation, the effects of climate change. How is Irish agriculture looking to do that, looking down the road to 20, 30 years down the road, as to if we have another fodder crisis, essentially? I speak as an absolute steak and cheese lover from West Cork, but at the same time, looking at the maths, they don't add up. Thanks very much.
Mary, do you want to take that?
Yeah, well, I can take part of one of the questions in what we're doing at farm level. And I already alluded to the fact that we in Ireland are the only farmers where every one of us is going to be audited in terms of animal welfare, in terms of milk quality, traceability, health and safety on farm, as well as, you know, our social sustainability and also environmental sustainability. There's a whole section in the audit that is on sustainability. We are working on measuring and having a carbon footprint per farm. We now have a system called Carbon Navigator, and with the rollout of knowledge transfer, this is going to be rolled out to all dairy farmers, and they are going to go through the options of how we can lower our greenhouse gas emissions while remaining economically viable. So this is a system that we're putting in place. It is early days. We are communicating it among the dairy sector, but it is an effective way of reducing greenhouse gas emissions while remaining economically viable. We are working on it. There's great collaboration in the dairy sector with all key stakeholders, and it is an opportunity for us to take this challenge very seriously.
Okay, we have another question. Another two questions here. Sorry.
Yeah. Neil Walker. Taking other things as equal, such as good farming practice, manure management, the use of clover, extending the grazing season, there are a number of longer term, perhaps more science fiction things like vaccinations or eugenics to produce a more refined cow. Is that realistic? And if it is scientifically possible, what would the logistical challenges be for the 80,000 beef farms and the 20,000 dairy farms?
Just on that, I mean, evolution has genetic improvement, but as opposed to genetic modification, has actually improved animal productivity, even crossing breeds and developing hybrids, developing has improved efficiency. It's always been done simply on the basis of yield. So probably what the like to improve production with in as a backdrop or as part of the equation that the animal horticrop becomes more efficient from a carbon efficiency and the water usage efficiency, which is going to become more and more important even in this country, is I think probably where the likes of the scientists in Moor Park and other parts of Ireland and in other parts of the world should focus, and in our universities and colleges. Just a very simple one. In young scientists exhibition last year, two young fellows developed a technique, very, very labor intensive, of measuring an egg and determining whether that egg had a male or a female chicken inside of it. Okay.
But hasn't the Irish
so that
community
they didn't all have to be hatched out. I mean, imagine the amount. If you put that's just a very simple one. Sorry.
Hasn't the Irish science community come out recently and said there isn't enough funding for scientific research?
There's never enough funding for scientific research. To be fair, I mean, we have probably one of the most efficient agri research station locations in the world in Moor Park, who's driven by a grass based system. To be fair, I wouldn't always agree with it. To try and make the animals, to develop a breed of animal for the model of Irish agriculture that actually produces milk as efficiently as possible, using as much grass as possible, and also in as environmentally friendly fashion as possible, lowering greenhouse gas emissions by improving the rumen function and the grass that they graze, so that the milk that's produced, as milk is the product that's being produced in that case, is actually produced in environmentally as environmentally friendly possible.
How will it taste?
Sorry?
How will that milk taste?
I'm not
taste?
Going to comment.
Well, you see, that's where nobody talks about flavour or quality or food in these.
Sorry, Catherine, I can say, look, there's something there. First of all, the idea that science has been funded by Ireland is a nonsense. Absolute nonsense. Yeah, last Saturday, we were having a conference on soil in Galway, and the lovely Sophie Healy, who won the Young Scientist Ireland European and the Google Science Competition last year, an amazing girl in fifth year. We had great fun of going up to the genetic engineering labs with Professor Spillane and NUIG. And to talk what you were saying about Irish agriculture, there I saw a 3D printer where they were working with farming communities in Africa, live on the internet, looking at the tools they had, improving the tools in Galway, emailing out their results to a 3D printer in Africa. Amazing stuff going on. But the one thing we're getting is science in Ireland is only funded by commercial gain if you can copyright it. There is no funding now for serendipity or for research. But I am totally...
Surely there's money in building a better cow.
Yeah, I mean, it's not true, but that's why there was letters in the Irish Times signed by so many scientists. Like, that we have to stop commercialising our science and go back to looking at science as an art form that it was maybe 50 or 60 years ago, because that's where the great solutions have come from. But to answer your question, I love the idea of synthetic. After we were toured the labs, we spent an hour and a half discussing the synthetic development of cheese using plant matter and introducing looking at that 50 years ahead into how we can create food, plant-based food, and involve pleasure into it, not just tofu in a health food shop, but how science and pleasure can merge in the future to create different foodstuffs. So, I mean, there's an amazing... Science is moving so fast. I think this isn't all... It's not all bad news. And I think what Chagas are doing and what the government are doing, what Origin Green, I'm obviously part of that and part of Borbia. A lot of it is good. A lot of it is easy to fill out the forms. But there's some amazing stuff actually happening there. But we are... It's going to be one step being the world leader in quantifying what we're doing, and we are doing that. It's going to be this big job is to act on the results of how we quantify it and how we move to the future. So step two is going to be much harder than being world leaders in looking at what we do.
Thanks, Shane. We have a question here.
I just have a quick announcement and a question as well. This Saturday in Clock Jordan, if you know where Clock Jordan is, the Eco Village, there's a conference called Feeding Ourselves about national food systems. And the question to the audience is that we forgot to speak about the food systems. I am part of a group, we are based here in Dublin, it's called Community Supported Agriculture, CSA. And this is something that is growing up, not only in Dublin, but all around the country. And the idea is to link consumers and producers. We are working with two farmers. They are based in Selbridge. One is Seamus and Mike. and they come every week. They come here just down the road to Smithfield, and they deliver the what we call the basket of, with vegetables. And the question to you is that we are talking about access to land, but we here in Dublin, in the Liberties, everywhere, we want to grow our own food. We want to know where the food comes from, and we want to have access to food that is grown locally. I believe that CSAs and other alternative food systems is the way to go. I believe that people who are coming with me on Saturday, and we are going to discuss this in Clock Jordan in Tipperary, we will have the opportunity to talk about how these alternative routes are going to contribute, I suppose, for all these debates. I don't know, there's no representative here from the community gardens, there's no representatives from the CSAs, perhaps there is another time to discuss, but CSAs, community gardens, and all these, I suppose, local initiatives are having a great role. And if you want to know about the community gardens or anything else, you can talk to me after that.
Saturday,
and my name is Miriam. Thank
Saturday
you.
Saturday in Clock Jordan. Thanks very much. Okay. Are we done?
One more.
Chris is looming, I think.
Yeah.
Yes.
Can I have final, please. Well, maybe final question. I don't know if it is or not. Our friend from Chagas there was talking about how we're going to take in the whole sector of agriculture. The areas which are used as a carbon sump to be offset against the areas which are used within production. And the lady beside him was saying that every farm will be measured in its carbon footprint. So surely we have the elements there that if we are going to put a cap on emissions to provide a market within the agricultural sector, as we lower the emissions down within the agriculture and set those targets lower, to have a market there, to encourage farmers to adopt lower emissions farming than we have at the moment. And when farmers have to buy their emissions if they want to increase animals that are emitting a lot of CO2, maybe they'll make a different decision in the type of food that they will produce then.
Good. Just on that, that's fine, Tom. The first thing you have to do is calculate the true figure. The true figure, as Roger has said, because Kyoto determined that all forestry produced pre-1990 is not part of the calculation. So until we actually factor in, and that's why I said everything is about a total land use policy, factor in everything and then come at your figure. And look at, as I said, the uplands of Wicklow are carbon sinks by and large, not all of it, some of it open peat.
And huge tourist resources.
And it's a huge tourist
facility.
I mean,
they're not sitting
and
there not
there
making
there
money
was a guard on the bridge in Lara on Sunday and Monday saying it's full up there, you may go to Avondale. So the tourists are part of it, every bit as much as agriculture in that part of the world. But there are other parts in Ireland, rather. There are other parts of Ireland which can produce a lot of food very efficiently. Let's use the whole picture in the calculation and then work towards what you're saying.
Yeah, I think we have time for one more question.
I would like to make a point, because you're the first person who mentioned it, and that's the taste and flavour of food. It's great producing all this food and minding the environment, but food is made for people to eat, to grow, to get healthy, to nourish, particularly our children. Now, if you haven't the skills to do that, to cook food, to buy, to shop, to use it, there's not much good doing all this work. And at the moment in Ireland, the children who have medical cards cannot get the materials to learn how to cook. There's a subject on the school curriculum, which none of you have mentioned, which teaches culinary skills, nutrition, consumer education, and how to use this food to feed people correctly. And the children who have medical cards can have to supply their own ingredients for the compulsory practical exam. So when you talk about food, I would like people, please, to think about teaching the skills, how to cook food. Jamie Oliver is trying to introduce, again in England, which Maggie Thatcher destroyed, the whole skill of cooking and proper, cheap, easily produced local food to feed children healthy. So can I please put in, I taught it for 35 years and I'm still talking about it. Can we invest in our children and teach them how to cook good food properly?
Yep. It's all connected.
Can I just say about community supported agriculture, that is something that is important in schools, you know, because I think that should be in every rural village. But there, it is down to the people to come and do it in the garden, because I've seen many community supported agriculture where it's overgrown, no one's coming to weed, no one's coming to do anything. You know, it does happen that people like convenience, so it is actually everyone's problem. I mean, there's certain funding there, but you know, people need to also take it up, do you know?
And that's a brilliant point. And what you said about community gardening, I grew up in Dublin. The back of every garden around Portobello, we were producing lots of food. It doesn't really sound important. My mum's farm in Donegal had a market little garden at the back. We milked 4 cows. Doesn't seem important. You multiply that by 70,000 small farmers in Ireland. That's like a massive amount of food we're not producing in Ireland anymore because we just don't bother. But with your question, I leave you with this. We have a Department of Agriculture who want to have economic growth by processing food, by getting the most amount of food and not letting us cook it, but to process it and sell it back. We have a Department of Health and Education who want us to use primary food. We all know that if we use primary food, it's much healthier. It's for a million reasons. The problem is that if we just purchase primary food, we have become too rich to produce our own food. And I don't have the solution to that. But on one side of the government, we want to encourage people to use primary food, and the other, our economic growth is dependent on us not. And if you have the answer to that, fair play. I don't have the answer to that, but it's a conundrum.
Thanks, Seamus. I'd like to thank everybody in the panel. I think it was a really good discussion. Thank Mary Delaney, Roger Schultz, Brida Larkin, Andrew Doyle, and Seamus Sheridan. And thank you all for coming. And I think it's a good phrase to end a conference about food. Let's go eat.
Okay, so thank you to Catherine. Next event is the 20th of April. If you have it in you, if you could just write down the card that's on the seat, something that has become clearer to you. So following the conversation this evening, something that has become clearer to you. We just want to keep capturing what's going on. So just write down a few words about something that has become clearer to you. Thank you very much.